谢谢大家，咱们现在就开始了。今天下午的活动会有四个部分，先是一个讨论，是关于开源社区在中国发展的讨论，然后会有三个演讲。然后跟上午一样的话，就说那个你有任何问题的话，就说请把它问题写在，你可以直接起来说，也可以就说是把它写在纸上，然后交给我们两边的同事。我们的那个主要语言会是用英语。Okay, so, maybe we can get started. So, like, so let's first maybe give a brief introduction of each guest. Like today, we are very honored. We have some big names, gurus from Open Source Society. So.First is John, you already met like in this morning session. And the second is... And second is Guido, he is the creator of Python. And third is Mike, he's the VP engineering of Mozilla.Joe is the author of SCIM, that is the Chinese IME on Linux. And that is Yu. Yu is running an interesting open source project called Sky. So today is a great opportunity, even though it's a panel discussion, but we want to leave most of the time for the audience to ask questions.I will do the starter two questions, and then all the time are yours. So before I go to the questions, like, I want to do a very, very quick story. So like, for all the guys here, like, how many of you have ever used an open source program? Please raise your hands. Wow, a lot. Great. And then my second question is, like, how many of you are currently working in an open source project? Still fair number.Great. So, my first question for our guests is like, when did you first become a contributor in the open source community? And what motivated you? So you want to start from John?
Is this on? Okay. I can remember exactly when I started. I had been using Linux. Like I mentioned earlier, I'd been using Linux and open source software for a really long time. And I used it first when I was in school, and then I was fortunate enough after finishing school to be able to be working still with Linux and writing software, you know, internal software for a company. And I actually went to I was very interested in it, but I'd never really contributed. And I went to one of the early Linux expos in the United States. This was a long, long time ago. It was like 1997 or something like that. And it was this very exciting atmosphere. And I came out of that thinking I really want to start making contributions and not just be a user anymore. Just because what was going on was so exciting and the environment was so exciting. So then I started making my first little steps into writing software and contributing it out there. So I guess the lesson is maybe someone out there will be excited by this event and will be inspired to contribute.
I don't really remember because open source had not been invented when I started giving software away. So at some point when Python already had a sizable user community, people were telling me, there's this new term called open source that describes exactly what you're doing. Do you want to apply that to Python? And at first I thought, I don't care. I don't care what they call it.So it took about a year later, then I met Eric Raymond, and he convinced me that I should really jump on the open source bandwagon, and then I started calling it open source. So I would say probably from day minus 2000.
So I had been, can you hear me? Yeah. Okay. I had been a long time user of open source, particularly Linux and Postgres, doing a lot of server applications, but in a relatively newcomer, I think, compared to these guys. When it comes to contributing to open source, I joined the Mozilla project about 2 years ago, and I think did it for the same reason everyone else does, which is I couldn't think of a better way to spend my time impacting people's lives and a chance to contribute to a project that has so much effect on the world. and with a group of people who are amazingly passionate about what they do. And so I thought that that was a great way to spend my time and have loved every day since.
所以我一开始的时候呢，就这种需求，说，我想玩
Linux，然后非常方便。那么虽然我一开始是作为自己的兴趣爱好，或者自己的需求，但后来我把它open source以后放在网里面，很有意思的是引起了很多的那个用户的这种共鸣吧，很多用户给我发信说他们有这样的需求，而且我的小软件正好是需求，然后这个就非常激励我，而且我觉得很有成就感啊。然后一直做下去，这是我的开始，好，谢谢。我也用中文说，因为我这个接触软件呢，是像开软件也是在大学期间，因为是在大约是九五年左右啊，1995年左右。 然后在其实，对开源做贡献呢，实际上也谈不上，这样主要是也是属于科研的一个需要，就是我主要研究方向是偏超系统和嵌入系统这一块。当时呢就发觉，如果要做对超系统进行分析调试的话，那么比较困难，需要一些很高端的一些工具。为此呢想通过设计一个就是通过软件来模拟一个硬件，模拟这个整开板来实现就是对超系统的一个跟踪和分析。 这也是为什么就是Sky产生的一个原因，它实际上就是一个硬件的一个模拟器。那么实际上它也是来源于开源社区。为什么这么说呢？因为最开始的时候，我当时就是在网上查找的时候，是基于Mucinex这个组织他们自己做了一个emulator。那么我对它进行了进一步的改进和扩展，然后再发展到现在的Sky。所以说，Sky目前也是开源软件，也确实得到了一些其他的一些无论是学生还是公司的一些开发人员的一些使用。
On behalf of our guests, maybe I give some quick translation. So here is that both of them like start doing participating like using some open source software when they are in college. Like when they start working on the operating system like Linux, like around 95, 97, 98, and then later on like. Joy is because of interest, they build some like software, and then Sky get a very popular usage, and he start getting into the open source community and start become a contributor. And for you, he is working on some academic project, and that project has some like overlap with the open source cause, and then later on he began doing some simulator, that is the open source simulator, and then become a contributor in the open source society. Cool. So it looks like the one of the common pattern here is like that we start doing some like either because of personal interest or because of some accidental like a project overlap. So we start doing something in open source and then like gradually become a first is other users of the open source and then later on become a contributor in the open source society. That's pretty cool. So one little bit different than really like that from our US colleagues is more like a more on the early stages, like maybe like some like a year, already like become a contributor in the open source community for quite some time. And but our Chinese guests like is like a little bit younger or have been like become a contributor for the last like a few years. So like, I think that's the common thing like in China and compare China and to the U.S. as well. Like the open source community thing like in China has like really taken off, get a strong momentum. But it's still in the very early stage. So right now, like from our survey, you can see like many of our people already know about open source and become users in open source, where a small portion of them now have become a contributor. I hope like down the way, more and more people here will become a contributor in the open source community. So my next question is for Zhe and Yu is that I know you guys are the leader in the open source projects in China. So what are your experience of running open source projects in China? And what are the questions you want to ask our colleagues?
其实我后来可能比较大家知道多的这个项目就是那个SAM的这个输入法，那一开始这个SAM的这个输入法项目呢也是源于我自己的需求，因为我做 Linux 我玩 Linux， 然后输中文很痛苦啊，在一开始的时候这个输入法都很烂，所以呢后来我就痛定思痛，我觉得如果没有人做的话我就开始做吧，我自己做一个输入法给我自己用好了，那后来呢我就把这输入法开放到网上，供大家一块去试用。那么，其实，在开放以后呢，确实得到非常多的用户的这种响应。那么，用户数量是很多的，而且，后来，我把这输入法变成了一个国际化的项目，不光是支持中文的输入，支持而且支持很多外国语言的输入。那后来
，So I can do the simultaneous translation here. Is that good? Just said that he started working in open source when he's doing the IME project, the reason why he started the IME project because he found inputting Chinese into the system is very hard on Linux. So he experienced the pain and then he think that he should fix it and he started a project of a Chinese IME project. And the product get many positive feedbacks. So and also get many good suggestions from the people who are using it.
Yeah. 但是虽然有很多很多的用户。但是真正我这个项目参与我这个项目开发的，然后给我这项目贡献，比如说贡献代码、贡献补丁，甚至贡献文档的这种贡献者呢，到目前为止其实是很少的。那其实这也是我困惑我很困惑的一个主要的一个问题吧。
Okay, so one question that Joe has is that even though now there are many users of his product that is SEIM, but the people who participate in the project and contribute to the project are still very few, right now not many people.
而且其实后来呢就是到了后来以后我发现比如在国内做输入法项目的人是越来越多了，做 Linux 输入法项目的。那么我所知道大概就有三四个开发者在各自开发自己独立的这种项目。那么其实我很希望大家能够齐心协力吧，把某一个产品做得非常好，这样的话才是对用户最好的。那么现在的问题就是说有很多开发者他是尤其是国内我觉得这样，就是说可能都很感兴趣，而且都喜欢自己去尝试一下，那么最后导致一个问题就是说可能这种力量过于分散了，那么可能我觉得这个对这种项目也不是特别的好。
Okay, so one observation Zhe has is that actually for the IME project not only him, he noticed also quite some other developers individually also doing the IME projects, but the efforts are kind of scattered, there's no coordination of all these projects. So I think his observation is that we need some more coordination orMore collaboration among people so that we can building some really big and a good product. And I guess I try to rephrase, I guess your question is from your guys' experience, what is a good way to encourage a good collaboration and a coordination among open source people?
其实这两个这就是我主要的，就是说在国内开发一个开源项目的一个主要困惑。所以第一点就是说怎么样才能够真正的吸引更多的开发者参与的项目？你第二个，怎么样才能够把社区里面这种志同道合的做同样一件事情的人都集中起来？那么大家齐心协力做好一个项目。
Okay, so in summary, the question there are two questions. One is how to motivate more people to come into the open source community and make contribution here.And the second is how we can do a better coordination work so that the people can work together more efficiently and more effective. So I guess maybe we can answer the question for us and then go to you next. So you guys want to talk first?
It's our standard work.
Now, in terms of, it's always a problem getting developers, right? Because there's just never enough developers to go around. It feels like. I think a lot of there's a lot of people who want to contribute to open source projects, but who maybe feel a little intimidated, or they don't really know how to contribute. So I guess that, you know, one thing we did on Beagle, which was worked pretty well, is some people show up, they just want to help. Sometimes people have a specific thing they want to implement, and they will usually come and do it. But other people want to help, but they don't really know how they can help. So it's often helpful to sort of maybe keep a list of, like, often simple tasks, right? There's always a million small things that you would do if you had time, but you just never get around to, right? So even just writing those down, putting them on the website somewhere, saying, here's a list of 10 little things that are pretty easy to do, maybe someone will do them. And then, you know, you'd be surprised. You know, you might just get an email one day where someone, you know, finds this, and they say, oh, then they know what to do, then they have some direction, and it's easier for them to get started that way. So, yeah, there's like a little list of simple projects is one way to do that.
An observation I have is that when you get, as an open source project sort of owner, you get a lot of contributions that need a lot of work. At least for Python, I have a very high standard of code quality, and of course, I don't want contributions to add features that might crash the system in the language in other situations. So sometimes it's tempting to ignore those contributions or just tell them, sorry, it's not good enough, try again. Or to sort of take the idea of the contribution and rewrite it yourself. But then you've lost the potential contributor with that, because that person who sent a flawed patch will never try to send you another patch. He'll find another project, maybe, at best. And at worst, they'll just turn away from open source contribution altogether. So even if it would take, even if it would take me more time to help a contributor turn their patch actually into the code of quality that I would like to see, if even if that would take more time than just writing it myself, it is still good use of my time to help that person improve their code until it's ready for inclusion, because then they will come back and do more, and they'll learn, and the next time it will be easier, and before you know it, they are a major contributor. At least that has happened on a number of occasions in Python. We have a couple of new core developers that just started that way and just kept coming back for more.
I think one of the things that's been interesting in the Mozilla project is it's very daunting for a developer to try and join an open source project, because especially one that's been around a while, like Linux or Firefox or even Python, because there may be a very big existing code base and lots of features, and so people don't know where to start. So we've seen a lot of people get started helping any way they can, including things like testing and filing bugs and reproducing things, because there's a lot more to building high-quality software than just writing code. Sometimes it's just organizing other people, you know, doing a release plan or testing out the software and reproducing bugs. And that starts getting them into the project and getting them knowing what parts are interesting, what parts need work, and then they'll slowly evolve into trying to write small patches for those parts of the code. At that point, they already know many of the other open source developers. The next thing you know, that person's a top core contributor. So I think that the other thing to keep in mind is there are lots of ways to engage and be involved and help an open source project besides diving right in and trying to, you know, work on the new big major feature in that product, because that's a very hard place to start.
跟国外就有一些差异，我个人感觉，因为我现在在一个学校里面当老师，那我感觉到就是从这个第一个是用的方面来说，就是实际上在我们在你成为一个将来成为一个工程师或者说成为一个工作人员之前呢，首先你是个学生，那么在作为学生这个阶段呢，我感觉就至少在我们大学里面对这个开源软件的一个使用或者是基于它做一些研发这方面实际上并不是很普及。这一块我觉得是我们就是大学的自身的一些就是现状， 然后导致比如说我现在给大三上课的话，大三很多学生可能还不用没有用过是 Linux， 更谈不上怎么去基于 Linux 做一些开发了，我觉得这是一个问题。第二个问题就是我觉得就是大家可能也有观察，就是国内和国外的大学做一些 project， 那么这 project 呢在国内基本上也就是说做了这个东西，但是他做的什么东西他并不 open 出来，而国外我发觉有很有这方面一些就是一些传统的说一些历史上的一些原因，他们就是愿意把他们的东西 open 出来，这样给在学生阶段就培养出一种就是 open 的一种这种精神也好或者文化也好，那么这一点呢我觉得在我们国内这方面就是可能还有待进一步的改进。
That's definitely so from a youth observation, like he noticed that theThere are something like a difference between China and maybe like other country like US. Like one is that in the university education, like in college, so in China, in college education, the open source and like Linux and other related courses are not well covered. So when people, like when students like the third year, they probably still don't have a good knowledge in open source. I think that's that's probably one problem. And the second problem is that in China, like by culture-wise, like or maybe for some traditional reason, like in college, the projects or in university, the projects are not as open as that in US. So like people don't really know what projects are going on in each university. So that can cause some other trouble as well.
Okay,
so his question is like that in US, for example, like how do people, when do people get involved into the open source? Like, do they already get some knowledge in college? Is that the situation?
I actually don't think that U.S. colleges do at all a good job of teaching open source. most students I meet, if they haven't gone off and done it on their own, they may have used Linux in classes, but they know nothing about what open source is in terms of the project and how you contribute and get involved and what it means to have a code review done by someone else on the project. These are all things they learn by going off on their own and working on it. So I think it's definitely not an issue in the education. It's more about people just stepping up and trying to get involved and trying out these open source projects, because they're the ones that we see get involved and do things. I don't know if you guys agree or disagree.
Yeah, no, I agree. I mean, it's in universities in the US, and some you'll probably learn. They're not going to teach you open source. Maybe you'll use Linux, maybe not. But I think the thing is it's sort of floating around out there, right? And the students it's out there enough that the students are interested, they discover it. So this is the kind of the good news from your standpoint is you don't need to convince your professors to do something differently to really have a big effect. It just has to sort of be, this sort of has to be floating around out there. And if it's there and people kind of hear about it from their friends, that people hear about it from their friends, right? I mean, or stumble across it. They don't learn it from their teachers. So just tell your friends, kind of have it be in the air, and people in schools will discover it. And I've noticed it takes 4 seconds every time you clap. So I'm suggesting we not clap after every response, because that's 20 seconds for 5 of us. So we have to be efficient in our use of time.
Motion rejected. I didn't go to college in the US, nor was open source really invented, but I do know that there is a lot of similarity between the ways of open source and the ways of academic publication in general. I mean, peer review, working together, sharing ideas, sharing results, even sharing negative results. That those are all things that go on in academia and that go on in open source. So there is at least that advantage you have in college. I would think that sort of is helpful for open source. It helps a little bit with the mindset.
So
you know that.
That's good. That's good to get there. So we do want to like open the time, most of the time, like to our audience. Like feel free to raise your questions. you can either like stand up to ask your question or write down your questions on a paper and give that to our colleagues at the two sides. And yeah, and you can also speak in Chinese as well. So and we can do the translation. Okay. Just 1 second.
What kind of role do you think our university should play in open source movement? To my knowledge, like Berkeley and Stanford plays important roles in open source. For example, FreeBSD and NS2 or something else. So what's your opinion?
So the question is like, what kind of role do you think university should play in the open source area? And he think that Stanford and Berkeley have played an important role there in US. So,
well, I mean, I think that universities can play a very big role. And like Guido said, there's a very natural, the sort of the mission of the university feeds nicely into open source because there's so many learning opportunities when you use open source. That's one of the wonderful things. Like the process Guido described of working with a contributor. I mean, I've seen the same thing he saw many times. So it's always a pleasure to see people learn and grow in their knowledge of programming from working with them in an open source project. But I do think the role of, the official role of universities is a bit overstated in terms of even in the US and their contribution to open source. I'm always disappointed by how little open source software comes out of official channels of universities. Lots of open source software comes out of the universities, but it's because of students working on it. And it's still pretty rare for professors who are doing writing software as part of their research to release it as open source, and when they do, they usually don't do a very good job of it. And maybe it's because the university system doesn't really value writing a paper about a piece of software. They don't value doing the engineering to produce a piece of software and make it for mass consumption. So don't look, I mean, Berkeley and Stanford are wonderful institutions from a computer science standpoint, but probably not things institutions that can serve as inspirations for us in terms of how to make open source better. So I think it has to come from the students, it has to come from the bottom up.
Actually, many of the questions are about Google, not particularly about the open source, so you can ask the question in other session, but in this session, we would like to focus on discussing about the open source and what the open source development direction in China. So
let me just interject. So apparently at 5 o'clock, we're all gonna be standing out here to answer your questions. So if you have very specific questions, you can, or you know, that would also be a good time to ask us Google type questions when we're at 5 o'clock in the speakers area out here. So sorry.
Okay. So here we get a license question. So also about license, that is like the Pro DBI is under GPL or artist license, which helps to connect with my circle. So if I write a module subclassing the DBI, can I relicense the module to Apache license? Thanks. So I don't know really that's relevant or some. Do you guys have some comments on license? I know there are some like distribute or like some arguments on license whether GPL is good and whether like.
I'm a big fan of the BSD license. Simple is better.
And also we see a suggestion, it's like that this talk is about open source and Linux, but our logo or somewhere like still have a Windows XP on it. Yeah, I think we'll fix it.
Hey, Jim, we have a question from here.
Yeah.
Yes, I have a question. How does open source project benefit for the future development?
Okay.
You mean sort of the benefit of development in general? Or you mean how do we make the world better, or how do you make a specific open source project better?
Earn money.
I'm sorry?
Earn money.
Oh, earn money.
Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, that's a hard problem, right? If Look, this is not just open source software, right? I mean, the way to earn money is to solve somebody's problem for them, right? If your software doesn't solve somebody's problem, whether it's open source or closed source, you're not going to make any money off of it. If you make something that's compelling and solves a real problem for people, there should be a way to turn that into some money, again, whether it's open source or closed source. Other than that, I think, like I said earlier, you know, working on open source software looks good, it can give you reputation, and maybe that'll help you get a better job, and that can make you indirectly earn money. But making money from open source software is a difficult problem that perhaps others have something to say about.
The other way to think of it is that the difference between open source software and closed source software is one of contribution and leverage. So if you write closed source software, it's you and whoever else you can pay or convince to work on it. If you work on open source software, you may get help from hundreds or thousands of people all around the world to contribute to make that software better, so you get a lot more leverage, you can get a lot more done. Most of the open source projects that are out here today wouldn't be able to succeed, you know, under the umbrella of one small organization because they have contributions from people all over the world. So you still need to figure, you know, a problem to solve, some other way to create value out of that. But in terms of building really great software, it's a way to harness the energy and creativity of people all around the world. So that's one of the big differences.
Okay, is this on?
Yeah.
So I see that most of the open software out there is open source software, is binary applications that people run on their own computers. And these days the world is kind of shifting to Web 2.0 and web-based applications. Do you guys see open source web applications where, for example, I guess things are happening with Facebook now and things like that, but these are still pretty much closed. You keep your project to yourself. There's an API. But do you see people starting a website and then saying, here's the code, why don't you help me with that? Or does the commit process of that just make that unfeasible?
I'll take a wing at that. So I think there's two things. One is that the difference with online applications is the really important thing there is your data, right? So when I have Gmail or Facebook, I've input a bunch of stuff. There's my email, there's my calendar data, there's all of these things. So it's really important that I be able to get to that data and take it somewhere else if I really want to. So I think more than on the desktop, the important thing on the server side, since my data is living in someone else's server, it's really important for me to have open access to my data, which is completely separate from whether the code is open source or not. I think as it was discussed earlier today, the hard part about open sourcing server software, I think for most people, is it's really tied to their infrastructure. So, you know, even if they give you the source code, you probably won't be able to run it. Having said that, I think that, you know, the use of Linux and Apache, PHP, Python, all of the core building blocks that people are using to build websites are these days, are open, and that's really important because that's where lots of people can share the work and get leverage again on all of that.
Yeah, and I'll just interject, the shift to web-based applications definitely changes the landscape a lot for open source software, but, you know, there's more code, and yeah, server side is tricky, but there's more and more code executing in your browser, right, JavaScript code. There's no reason that can't be open source software in the same way. Maybe, in fact, in many cases, unless it's obfuscated, it kind of by definition is open source software, because you're delivering something that looks a lot like source code to the user's machine. And then there's things like, I mean, I don't want to really be a shill for Google here, I mean, but there's like Google Gadgets and things like that. So I think there's a move towards sort of creating code that executes somewhere else than on your box, or executes in kind of a different way or in a different paradigm. And I think there's no reason open source can't extend to the new paradigm, so it is going to look different. And I think none of us really know how that's going to shake out in the long term.
But that's not happening right now, really. Is that happening right now?
I think it's starting to happen. I think it's starting to happen a little bit separately from the traditional open source movements. I think a lot of open source projects sort of haven't caught up to the changes that are happening with the web. And I think, you know, they will inevitably, or they'll be replaced by something that is a mutant version of open source software as we know it now. I mean, open source, the idea of open source is not going away. It's too powerful. It's just a question of whether existing projects have to evolve, just like companies have to evolve to meet the new challenges, or they will not be successful in the long term.
So, you and Dave, would like to comment?
Okay, actually, there's a question in, the guy said that he's running an association of software in some university. and they have a Linux group, and they want to spread Linux, but they don't know, they don't get enough support, and they cannot work with Microsoft, of course. And so, how can we get support from you and the community? So, the Zhe and Yu said, like, from the China community side.
就是说这个问题就是说是他们在那个在他们有一个Linux的小组，但是他们想就是说扩继续扩展Linux的影响，但他目前没有得到就是没有足够的支持，然后他们想问就是如何获得这些支持。其实我觉得从我的角度来讲呢，就是说个人感觉现在这个在学校里面有很多这种兴趣小组，比如清华就有这样的 Linux 他们会定期的聚会，然后去讨论一些基础相关的问题之类的。但是，确实好像，因为比如说，尤其在学校里面这种小组，可能跟外界有或多或少的这种一些障碍或者怎么样，可能会跟社区里面、跟这种国外的社区的一些会比较的松一些，不是那么紧密。那么，其实我觉得，其实很多小组其实，比如说在学校里面，不一定非要局限在清华或者北大或怎么样这样的这种学校校园内。那很多小组可以是大家比如说，如果有工作的这种校友啊或怎么样，都可以回去跟这些学弟学妹们去交流。那么，如果作为我的话，我是很希望，比如说像我们这种毕业以后的这种有经验的这些开源工作者，能够经常回到学校。 回到这种社区里面，跟大家去交流，这样的话可以带领这些新一代的人去进入到开源的这种领域。我想在这方面可能陈老师会有一些经验，他怎么样在学校里面去，比如说帮助这些新一代的这种爱好者去学习 Linux 之类的。Okay, just give me a second.
So just like that. Actually, in some universities, there are Linux organizations. They have activities educating on Linux and other open source stuff. But they seem like that those activities organizations are just within that university, such as like Tsinghua and Beida. So Zhe would encourage like more collaborations among universities, and also he would encourage people who have already been in industry come like and also have been a lot of experience like in Linux and open source to go back to school and do more education and give lectures to students so that they get more people in the open source community, and so Zhe volunteer for that.
我提一下我个人的一些看法吧，因为毕竟是代表其他的，就是我个人觉得，像我觉得，我们国家的开源软件，我觉得最应该的，目前我觉得最应该还是应该从学校里面来推动，来进一步的支持。 那么这个支持呢，我觉得其实学生据我理解，就是学生在中国，学生是一个很热情的一个团体，他们对开源软件充满了热情，但是缺乏一定的引导，这点我觉得是比较重要的。那么至少像我现在在大学里面上曹系统 （Operating System） 和那个 Bat System 这两门课，那么我就从各个侧面来引导学生能够进一步的了解和熟悉 Open Source 的一些东西，比如说基于 Linux 或基于其他一些 Open Source 的一些 Software。 来做一些教学，无论是教学还是做实验，都基于他们来做，这样可以促进学生对这个的了解。那么另一方面呢，我觉得我们国内就是做 open source 有一个好像我觉得有个误区，非要是自己做的才认为是一个比较好的一个 project。其实我觉得，就目前来说，我们能够积极的参与到国际上一些open source 一些 project 里面去，就是应该是很不错的。举个例子，比如说我们现在我上超系统课，那么我让学生。 如果说你让学生去找个 Linux， 我觉得 it's very difficult， 就是它挺困难的，比较大的一个比较复杂的一个 operating system。那我们可以基于一些小的，比如说 RTOS， 一些 embedded OS， 那基于它呢，参与到国外的一些开源的 open source 的一些embedded OS 的一些研发里面去。那么我想就比较容易能够融进到这个国外的这种开发的一种 open source 的开发的环境，从而促使学生能够熟悉和掌握怎么去加入到 open source 的一些。项目的开发，或者说进一步的学习中去。
Okay, so let me do some brief translation here. Is that you think that first is that Linux and open source education should start from universities? For example, he's currently teaching some classes in Tsinghua University, and during these classes, he taught about how open source works and how Linux operating system works, and he thinks that will be really useful. And second is that when people students have a lot of enthusiasm in Linux and open source projects, but when searching for projects, you don't have to limit to only China projects. You can also look out for international open projects, because in China, right now there may be not many open source projects, but we can start with some open source projects existing, maybe not in China, and then you can get more understanding of the open source stuff, and then later on start open source projects in China. So my question for you guys is how do you think how that work how people get support of to do open source and do Linux stuff for example in US or in other countries? Any good suggestions here?
Well, I guess the way you get support for open source projects is usually there's a mailing list, or sometimes there's IRC channels, and you get support from volunteers. But most open source projects, if they're successful, it's probably because there's a spirit of liking to help people in the project. So again, sometimes people, particularly new people who are not used to sending mail to a mailing list, maybe you feel a little nervous about that. But and maybe also I think my worry is that maybe in Asia there's some concern about the language barrier, because it might be an English language mailing list. You might be concerned about that. But I think most people really want to help. If you're having a problem, they're writing the software for you to use, and it makes people happy when they find out people are using it and are interested in it. So, just be brave, right? I mean, if just find the mailing list and send a mail to them, or find an IRC channel. And a lot of bigger projects, they have an IRC channel where people are just sitting there all the time, waiting to help you. And they really do want to help you. So just be brave and ask, and if they don't answer, use something else, because they don't deserve to have you as a user. So the huge question is that for people abroad, when they're doing open source stuff, how they support themselves, how do they get the food?
Well, it can happen in many different ways. For example, the Mozilla project currently employs about 100 people worldwide to work on Mozilla. So they do that as a full-time job to work on the project. And that's mostly because Firefox has become such a successful product out there, something that people really enjoy, something that they use, and have found a way to get revenue. Obviously, there's Linux companies that make revenue by selling support. There's companies that build other software on top of open source and then employ people to help with open source. So I think we're actually still figuring it out in the United States. There's more than a few startups that are going to go out of business trying to make money on open source, but a couple more will make it and figure out new models for doing it. But I think the key thing is to find something that you enjoy doing and find a project and product and make it successful, and then you can kind of figure out the rest from there.
Excuse me, I have a question. A general consideration on open source projects is they always lacking good documentation. And what do you guys think is engineer who might create code will simply don't have the really the right good documents? Thank you.
So kind of as I said earlier, I think that producing great software requires more than just writing code, a lot more. Actually, it's often much more other stuff than writing code to get good products out there. Documentation is one thing. Finding bugs and reproducing them is another. you know, packaging it up so someone can actually install it on their machine, right, which isn't writing code. It's pretty critical to make sure that your project is successful. And so I think documentation is another area where someone who doesn't write code or maybe is too nervous to write code in a project can get started by reading code and talking to the developers. And I'll tell you, if you ever talk to a developer on a project and say, hey, I want to help with the documentation, they are going to be really happy that you're helping out. And they'll spend the time to get you educated and help you get involved. So I think that things like documentation and testing and release management and all of these things are really great ways for people to break into open source projects, and I think frankly are critical to making open source projects really high quality software, which is ultimately what makes anything successful. Is it's a great thing, product, software that people want.
Yeah, I'll just interject. As open source has become more well known and more common in the United States, we have more and more non-technical people using open source. And I think a lot of non-technical people think they can't contribute because they don't know how to write code. But there's a lot of people who want to. I hear that people want to contribute because they like the philosophy of open source and they like the ideas behind it. But they just don't know that they don't know we need people writing documentation. So if you have friends who like some piece of, maybe say you have a friend who uses OpenOffice or Mozilla or anything, right? And they're not technical, but they say they like open source. You can tell them, well, you can help on open source too. Probably people who, because writing code and writing documentation has two different sets of skills. In a perfect world, you know, programmers would write all the documentation themselves, but we don't live in a perfect world. So encourage your less technical friends to help with the documentation.
Hi, I have a question. Let me read the question from paper first and then give you a direction. So this question is actually for Google. It's like how Google see free software and open source. So John?
You mean free GPL style free source software versus BSD Apache style open source? Is that the question?
This question is last. So today we focus open source, but I know open source come very good from free software just remove. So many places is free software, but. More and more is open source. So I ask, I just want to know the Google how to play that.
Okay, so basically the question is like, there are different licenses for open source programs, like they are totally free, and also there are some like GPL licenses. So how do you think about the different type of licenses?
So, I don't know, well, like I said before, our preference is to release software under the Apache license, because it's very simple, and that's, I guess that's open source and not free software, in some definition of those words. But, you know, we like both, right? I mean, no matter what you call it, you know, whether you call it free software or whether you call it open source software, whether it's the GPL or the BSD or whatever, there's more alike there than different. Some of the things are really of only interest to lawyers, right? And the most important thing is that the code is open and that people can build on it and share it. So we don't really have, you know, we don't really have a strong opinion about that.
My answer score is in the Google Store. You just support the free software more and open source more in Google Store.
From Google's perspective.
Summer of Code?
In Google, you mean that in Google's code? So she's asking like from Google's perspective, like which type of license Google is more supporting or.
Well, like I said, our default choice is the Apache license, but we don't, our only sort of philosophy with licenses is, you know, if we make a contribution to a GPL program, we're going to, you know, we hold the copyright to that, but we're going to put that under the GPL, right? I mean, so we prefer the Apache license because it's easier, right? I mean, so we don't really have a strong opinion there, except that we want to make things easy and simple. The one thing, like I mentioned, that we do not like is when every project makes up their own weird license. That's bad. That actually becomes a barrier to accepting open source. One of the things that the open source group in Google one of the things we spend a lot of our time on is just making sure that the way Google uses open source software is all legal. We don't want to break the law. And it's when there's a million different licenses, it's very, very hard, even if you try very hard to have not break the law, and if you have a bunch of open source experts, it gets so complicated, you know, it's too easy to make mistakes. So we're very against license proliferation. That's one of the reasons why when you go on project hosting on code.google.com, we only allow projects from a certain short list of licenses, because we don't want to encourage this proliferation. But other than that, the GPL is good. If you like the GPL, use that. BSD is good. If you like BSD, use that. Use what you like, and that's fine with us.
I would want to add one thing to that, that most software that is open source is also free software, and most software that is free software is also open source. You'd have to look, search really hard to find something that is open source but not free software, or vice versa. They don't have a perfect intersection, but they're very close.
Okay, I'm just wondering how for the projects, how you maintain projects when they start to take on different flavors. Like you have maybe stackless Python, Iron Python, or maybe SwiftFox and iSweezel. So how do you keep the core values of your project together and maintain them in terms of integrity?
Well, my opinion actually is more power to them. I don't necessarily make an effort to keep them together. I'm very happy that I have nothing to do with the project management in either Iron Python or Jython, so I can concentrate on core Python. We do talk, the projects all interact with each other, and each of the projects is sort of eager to maximize the compatibility between the different projects. And so the group at Microsoft that did Iron Python spent a lot of time making sure they're very compatible with CPython. And at the same time, when CPython evolves, when we have a language change or library change that we propose, we always think to ourselves and we ask the Iron Python guys, is it possible to implement this feature reasonably well in Iron Python, and the same with Jython?
Yeah, I guess I'd agree. I think forking is a feature, not a bug, of open source software. It's kind of one of the points, which is if the people working on it, if someone else has a better idea and they come along and they can get progress in motion and support in what they're doing, then more power to them. It shouldn't be control vested in one small group just because they were the ones working on it. So at any point in time, you can take it, run with it, and create your own product. And if the market and the users decide that that's what they really want, then that's who should win.
So for John, you had that problem happen with your projects as well?
So actually, SM输入法，到目前为止其实有一个所谓的那种分支版本吧，通用版本，就是叫 SKI，它是一个其实也是一个中国人，现在在英国留学的一个学生，帮助开发的，是完全基于KDE的技术开发的。那么所有的UI，所有的东西都是KDE的。那么但是它跟SM是要一个核心的。其实我们类似于这样，这两个项目是相对独立的。那么我觉得这个是一个很好的事情。 它扩大了SCM的这种适用范围，那么不同的人可以选择不同的这种适合他们自己不同的这种分支去用，我觉得这是很好的一件事情。
So just like that, in his project, like for the SCIM, actually there are another branch that so that now there are two products. Like one is SCIM, the other is SKIM. That is for the other like platform. So that's a very good thing because it will encourage more users to use this software.
我有一个问题要问一下，就是说那个我们在用开源软件的时候，就是说我们这边在给我的团队做整个的这个开源软件的系统做工作流的时候，因为整个的这就所有的开源软件基本上都是一个独立项目，他们之间整合性本身就非常弱，但是说这种情况下就是在整合性比较弱的情况下就是。 对于一些非技术人员，像那个我们那边的设计师、美工，还有一些市场营销这些人员，他们在这方面就是说工作流中就会出现停顿。 在这中间无法结合的部分，就需要技术人员来帮助协助去帮助他们去结合。就是说，我想问一下几位，就是说有没有什么建议，就是说能尽量让技术人员去干预这个工作流的运行，有没有办法来解决这个问题？
我有一次出现就说是那个在这边使用 Linux 的时候，可能很多非技术人员不熟悉你的产品，所以你想问
是这样，就是说几种软件吧，比方说就是说那个 GIMP 还有其他的一些跟开发软件也好，还有就是说后期的，我们这里就是说后期在用 Office 什么这些东西这些的时候，每一个软件他们几乎都是相对独立的，但是说把这个工作各个人的工作给他就整合起来的时候，做工作流就是 workflow， 就这样的时候，就中间就会出现这一个整个断层。这个断层是现在我们的办法，就是只有技术人员去干预，才能解决。
Okay, so I guess I get the meaning. So basically the question now is like in the open source product, in the softwares.Often it's that individual software, like for example, like OpenOffice and other programs. But when like in the working environment, when they want to use it, Open want to use like a kind of like a package of different programs. And there seem like now there's some kind of integration work. So like for non-technical people, it's not very easy for them to use like all the programs together. So often they need help from like a technical person. So.What are your comments on it, like, and what do you think we can do?
Well, I guess I'll, I don't know if I can answer that question directly, but, you know, before I started at Google, I was involved with the GNOME project, and then both at Zimian and Novell working on desktop applications. So, you know, we struggled with this a lot, too, just the trying to make open source software that's easy to use for...you know, for regular people, not just for computer scientists. And that's a hard problem. And the thing you mentioned is integration between apps. And that is a, you know, a very big problem. How many times have you been using Linux and you find like something, you know, you can't cut and paste between one application and another, or, you know, just something strange like that happens. And I guess this is one of the downsides of there not being, you know, some central figure, right? I mean, you know,Bill Gates can order that all the applications have to work together, and then people have to make them work together or they get fired, right? But if, you know, OpenOffice can't order Mozilla to make, you know, cut and paste work properly between the two or whatever, I mean, probably both projects want it to work together, and maybe it does, I haven't tried recently, just picking a random example. It's, you know, there's no, individual projects have benevolent dictators sometimes, but there's no dictator of open source software to force people to work together. And working together is very hard, and it takes a lot of time, and sometimes people don't want to do it, or it's a struggle. So this, I agree with you, this is a big challenge. I don't think there's a real easy answer other than, I think it's the thing which we have to do is we have to educate open source developers and remind them. Sometimes open source developers, it's easier to forget about the users, right? I mean, the user isn't giving you money. So people often write software for the satisfaction of it and for the joy of it. But so they're doing it for themselves. But sometimes they forget about the users along the way. And also sometimes they forget that as users, they are very different than the non-technical users. And it makes it hard for them to understand what's easy to use and what's hard to use. So just, you know, think when you're writing the software, think about, could my mother use this program? Now some of you maybe have very sophisticated mothers who are computer scientists. And I'm not trying to pick on mothers here. I mean, think about, could my father use this, right? I mean, it's probably the same question in most cases. So I think it's just educating people, encouraging people to think about usability issues, and encouraging, and just, if you try to cooperate with other projects, even if it's hard, and that's the only answer. I don't know if there's a better answer than that.
Listen to the users, they will tell you whether it works or not.
Yeah.
And if they say it doesn't, it really doesn't.
Yeah, don't argue with the users. The user is always right.
So our time is very limited, so like, let's ask the last two questions. So.
刚才前面就是提到了这个开源的是在中国发展比较艰难的一个问题，我觉得其中有一个原因是因为中国的程序员的生活都很艰难，因为大家都在努力加班。所以我想问一下，就是各位开源作者，包括国外的和国内的，问问你们在当初你们在开发你们的开源项目的时候，一定投入了大量的精力，那么当时你们一天大概要花多少时间在自己的开源项目上，以及你们是怎么样能够支撑自己，是由于你们的精力很充沛，所以白天上班晚上还能加班来做自己的事情呢，还是说是因为你们公司就像 Google 一样可以给你们充裕的时间来做自己的事，还是说因为当时你们是一个学生，所以你们有很多的时间来浪费，或者说是因为你们自己攒了很多钱，所以你们不在乎没有收入。
Very good question. So he said one of the reasons that why like open source didn't take really that off like in China is that the programmers, the developers, they are working very, very hard in China for their regular job. So often they often work overtime. So the question is like that for you guys like doing a lot of open source work, like how do you manage it? Like how much time you spend on your regular time and regular work and on open source work? And when you do the open source, like actually you are, because you are in school, so you have a lot of time to work on it, or it's because you have a lot of money already, so you don't worry about it.
I think you'll find a lot of people who work in open source who say they have two jobs. They have their day job, and then they work on open source on the side. There are others who are, you know, lucky to get to work on it as their full-time job. But there's plenty of students involved, plenty of people who work long hours on their job and spend their weekends or don't sleep much, I guess, and work on open source instead. So I don't have much advice for you there, except that there's a lot of people, I think, around the world that have that problem, have lots of other things to do, but it's their hobby, right? So everyone has something else they do besides work and sleep and eat. And for some people, that's writing code in open source.
There is another model, sort of in addition to that. You can have a service company that uses open source to solve other people's problems who cannot write code themselves, and you can make money just by combining applications, writing small applications, writing websites, and if you're clever, as part of that, providing that service, you also contribute to open source because you're using open source projects, and you make the open source project better for your own job, so you become more efficient at solving other people's problems who actually pay for it. So that's one way to make open source pay.
Yeah, and we have 1 second, but I'm just going to quickly interject. When we talk about first contributions, when I first got involved with open source, I was working for a company that I was using Linux and developing software for Linux, but it was for internal use in this company. So it wasn't a software company, it was a financial company. And when I wanted to get involved, I saw that some of the code I was writing was generic. My job wasn't open source, but I managed to convert a part of it to being open source. So that's something else to think about. You might have to educate your boss or people you work with, but maybe they'll say yes, it's worth a try.
我觉得刚刚您提的这些可能性都存在，只是每个人情况确实不一样。像我是，从学生毕业之后就成了老师，所以老师，我觉得大学确实有一个比较自由的一个氛围，它可以允许你干一些感兴趣的事情，反正国家给学校有拨款。
像我这边，就像您刚才说的，我在大学确实不务正业来的，所以我的专业是我是学物理的。所以不务正业到计算机行业了，然后很幸运的时候到计算机行业的话，从我上工作开始，我的这个主业就是 open source， 所以我还能够就是工作和兴趣基本上可以结合在一起了。
So one last question.
I think many open source software faced a problem.Some guys just steal the code from it without obeying the open source protocol. What do you think of that problem?
Now, when you say the open source protocol, do you mean violating the license or just violating the spirit of you know, making a change and not giving it back.
Yes.
I mean, if they're violating the license, they're, you know, they're, that's bad. They're breaking the law, and they shouldn't do that. If they're somehow violating the spirit of things, right? But if they say they take a BSD program and change it and don't give it back, don't give back the changes, I don't know. I mean, I don't think that's good. But it's a, you know, it's, they're free to do that. But breaking the law is bad. Whether you're a company or whether you're a person, you shouldn't do it.
Blog about them.
Yeah, it happens all the time. And often people violate licenses because they don't know better, right? They don't understand. I mean, legal things are complicated, particularly the legal system of other countries, right? I mean, a lot of this license stuff is kind of revolves around ideas from American law. They're probably very different than ideas from Chinese law. So it can be very confusing. But yeah, just shame and humiliate people who violate licenses. Mock them and laugh at them and write about them on your blog.
And don't use their software.
And make your friends not use their software.
SAM 现在也有很多人去用在自己的项目里面。比如说，据我所知，很多目前国内就有些，比如说做嵌入式的，他会把 SAM 泡到比如手机上或者嵌入设备上之类的。但是从我个人角度来讲，我是其实因为 SAM 本身是LGPL， 从 license 上讲的话，如果他要是去做这种 porting 或者去做这种任何的改变的话，它是需要 release 这个 source code。但是从我个人来说，我是无所谓的，越多人用越好。我觉得如果有人用这个，说明它有价值。对我个人来说，我是无所谓的。
Our time is already off, so let's finish here. But I know that there are a lot of questions, and you guys probably have a lot of more questions. And we will have all the speakers will stay around like after 5 p.m. and there will be some like places they will stay there, and you can talk to them. So there are still chances you can ask your questions individually. And let's thank you for all the speakers for the great talk.